time and place set for the State Judicial Nominating Commission to meet to interview the applicants who have applied to fill the vacancies on the Supreme Court created when the voters of Iowa did not retain Justices Turnus, Streit, and Baker in the last general election. At the conclusion of the interviews, the commission will go into closed session and select 9 names to send to the governor, from which he will select 3 to fill these vacancies. Before we begin, I would like to thank KCCI-TV and WHO-TV for providing equipment and personnel which makes it possible for the commission to stream these interviews live for all Iowans to observe. I would also like to thank my fellow commissioners who, without compensation, have and will spend hundreds of hours to fulfill their duties. The commission is made up of 7 ordinary citizens appointed by the governor that are confirmed by the Iowa Senate, 7 licensed attorneys voted in by other licensed attorney, and myself, the most senior member of the Supreme Court other than the Chief Justice. The citizen and attorney commissioners are selected from separate congressional districts. At this time, I would request each commissioner introduce him or herself, state his or her occupation, and tell us where they are from. I will begin. My name is Dave Wiggins. I am from West Des Moines, and I am a member of the Iowa Supreme Court. And let's start with Joe on the end there.
Good morning. My name is Joe Fitzgibbons. I'm a lawyer from Esterville, Iowa.
Hi, I'm Steve Pace. I'm a lawyer from Cedar Rapids, Iowa.
Good morning. My name is Jean Dixon, and I'm a lawyer from Davenport, Iowa.
Good morning. I'm Dave Cochran, and I teach political science at Loras College in Dubuque.
Good morning. I'm Colleen Deneve, and I'm a retired special education teacher from Ottumwa, Iowa.
Good morning. I'm Beth Walker, and I'm an attorney in Newton, Iowa.
Morning. I'm Tim Mickelson from the Grimes area. I'm a businessman.
Good morning. My name is Guy Cook. I'm a trial lawyer from Des Moines with the Grief and Sidney Law Firm.
My name is Mary Beth Lawler. I'm retired, but I work part-time at the Iowa Falls Chamber of Commerce, and that's where I reside.
Good morning. My name is Madeline Williams, and I am a supervisor for Procter & Gamble.
Good morning. My name is Amy Skogerson. I'm an attorney with Skogerson and Maxwell Luckband and Van Meter.
Good morning. I'm Margaret Redenbaugh from Storm Lake, and I'm a retired accounting professor from Buena Vista University.
Good morning. My name is Steve Brody. I live in Clive, Iowa, and I'm with a Pioneer Hybrid.
And good morning. My name is Dan Holm. I'm an attorney from Waterloo, Iowa.
The commission has allotted each applicant 20 minutes for his or her interview. The applicant may give an opening statement, which should last no more than 10 minutes. At the conclusion of the opening statement, the commission may ask questions. The public may not pose questions to the applicants. The yellow light on the timer in front of me will go on when there are 2 minutes left in the interview. The red light will go on when the 20 minutes allotted to the applicant has expired. We will strictly enforce the 20-minute time limit due to the number of applicants we need to interview in the next few days. We will now begin our first interview with Ms. Bumbary-Langston. Ms. Bumbary-Langston, you may make your opening statement.
Good morning, commissioners.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for the opportunity, first of all, to formally introduce myself and also to present my credentials and qualifications to serve on the Iowa Supreme Court. Now, I am joined by the love of my life, my husband, Ron, and we have a home in Des Moines, Iowa, in the Drake neighborhood. My interest in the Iowa Supreme Court and the appellate courts is longstanding. As a matter of fact, I applied for a position on the Iowa Court of Appeals in 1999. I was nominated, but not selected or not appointed. My interest in serving on the Iowa Supreme Court is grounded in my commitment to public service and my desire to uphold the Constitution of the state of Iowa and its laws. I believe that my qualifications and experience as a litigator, as an administrator, and my community service to this state makes me qualified to serve on the Iowa Supreme Court. Now, I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself because I did not get a chance to meet some of you. Now, I graduated from University of Virginia in 1978 and finished law school there in 1981 in Charlottesville, Virginia. At the undergraduate institution, was on the dean's list, and at the law school, I served on the moot court board and was a member of the honor committee at UVA. I also was an administrative fellow at Harvard University in Cambridge, Massachusetts. Upon graduation from law school, I had a judicial clerkship in Washington, D.C., and worked for the office of the mayor. Then I came to Iowa in 1985. I set for the Iowa bar, and my first job was as an Iowa Assistant Attorney General. I handled primarily prisoner litigation cases and got to travel around the state and see all of our wonderful prisons. After that point in time, I was appointed by Governor Branstad to serve as the Executive Director of the Iowa Civil Rights Commission, and I was there for 6 years. After my job at the commission, then I went into private practice. I was at the law firm of Brown, Winnick, Graves, Gross, Baskerville, and Schoenenbaum, primarily litigating employment cases, handling administrative matters, and I practice in both state and federal courts. After that, I was the civil chief at the U.S. Attorney's Office in the Southern District of Iowa in Des Moines for 10 years. During my tenure there, I also served as interim U.S. Attorney. At the U.S. Attorney's Office, I primarily, along with my colleagues, defended the United States in federal court, and we also litigated affirmatively on behalf of the United States. What I do now is I currently work for U.S. Department of Agriculture in the Office of the General Counsel. I serve as Assistant General Counsel for Civil Rights Litigation, and what I primarily do is supervise and manage attorneys who represent the department and the secretary. Community service has always been important to me, and I've been active in the community in Iowa, and I also served the Iowa legal community. I have made presentations in continuing legal education seminars. I've been active in the State Bar Association and various bar associations, be it the National Bar, the Polk County Women's Attorney Association. Also, I engaged in pro bono activity, which is itemized in my application. And I was an adjunct instructor at Drake University School of Law. I had the honor and privilege to serve as chair of an Iowa Supreme Court commission which looked at perceived biases in the Iowa courts and access to the Iowa courts. Now, when I think of the Iowa Supreme Court, I think of a very strong branch of government with a rich history and legacy and a national reputation for justice and equality, often in the face of adversity and public opinion. And two cases come to mind that I want to briefly talk about that I believe demonstrate the Supreme Court dedication to upholding laws in the Constitution. The first is the Iowa Supreme Court case of N. Ray Ralph. It was decided in 1839, and the court held that a slave who was allowed to come to Iowa, who was then free at that point in time, could not be reclaimed by his master because in Iowa, slavery was prohibited. This case was important in that 18 years later, the U.S. Supreme Court decided in the infamous Dred Scott case and came to a different conclusion. And another decision that profoundly impacted Iowans was the Iowa Supreme Court case of Clark versus Board of Education. This was a case where the Supreme Court decided it was illegal to prevent a young African-American girl to attend public schools in Muscatine. even in the face of public sentiment that the schools should be segregated. Again, the Iowa Supreme Court was out in front of the U.S. Supreme Court. That there was a decision, Plessy versus Ferguson, which upheld the separate but equal doctrine as the law of the land until reversed by Brown versus Board of Education in 1954. These decisions reflect independence, courage, fairness, and commitment to the rule of law as consistent attributes of the Iowa Supreme Court. I'd like to continue this legacy and would treasure the opportunity to serve. What about the roles of a justice? What are they? I believe that the most important role of a judge is to independently, impartially, and fairly adjudicate the law and uphold the Constitution. Iowa justices must write clear and thoughtful opinions based on the laws of the state and the Constitution. Equally important in this time of shrinking resources and increasing demands on the judicial system, Iowa justices have the responsibility of ensuring the viability of the Iowa courts and the unfettered access of Iowans to the courts. As a co-equal branch of government, the judicial branch must efficiently and effectively manage the case flow in the Iowa judicial system while still providing access to the Iowa courts. These very different responsibilities that are equal require a justice who does not only have the legal acumen to render a well-reasoned decision, but also the administrative experience to manage within financial and administrative constraints while protecting its integrity. It can be argued that one of the threats facing the Iowa courts is its isolation from the public. I think we've heard that, unfortunately. Specifically, some believe that there's an absence of a connection to the average Iowan to fully understand the role of the court, its legacy and its history and its function, and regrettably, the Iowa Supreme Court. The public, it's more familiar with the executive and legislative branches because people see those branches impacting their lives daily. Whereas the court may not be perceived as similarly engaged with the public as a whole on a daily basis, this can lead to misunderstanding of the court. As such, today, the court, under the leadership of the Chief Justice, has a responsibility, and I believe it's happening, to educate and work with the public, the legislature, and the executive branch, and also to work closely with the state and local bar associations. This responsibility will require a commitment by the entire court to ensure that it's not seen as an elite or faceless entity, but as a co-equal branch of the government charged with defending the fundamental principles of the American constitutional democracy. I believe, and I faithfully will, work hard for the court. In conclusion, it's important to encourage public participation in the judicial process. Public participation and discourse should not be curtailed because of a decision or a set of facts. It should be welcomed. Like the other branches of government in our democracy, a viable the viability and the integrity of the Iowa Supreme Court rest in a well-informed public, which has faith in the competence of the judicial system. I believe my legal experience in the private and public sectors, coupled with my administrative experience as a former state agency director and a federal supervisory attorney in the public sector equip me to execute the duties, responsibilities, as well as the administrative functions of the Iowa Supreme Court Justice. It is with great humility that I seek this position, and I ask for your serious consideration of my credentials and qualifications, and I further ask for your support to be a nominee to the court. Thank you.
Are there any questions from the commission? Joe, I'll start on your side of the table.
Thank you very much for those very enlightening comments. And as we start our arduous schedule of perhaps four plus days in this process, I want to thank you, and I want to thank each and every individual who's going to come before our group here for your hard work in putting together a very impressive body of information for us. And I want to thank you as well as each one of the individuals who have taken the time and the effort to come before this commission, because I think the mere fact that we have 60 Iowans who are interested in this position, who apparently believe in the validity of our process, that your participation validates what we're doing, and I want to thank you for that. And I have a couple of questions. With interest, I noted your reference to In re Ralph, the 1839 case that our court decided in the area of civil rights. I suspect in 1839 that might have been a controversial decision. Here we find ourselves many, many years later with a controversial decision that our court handed down. My question to you, ma'am, Ms. Ingram-Bumbry, is do you believe that the sentiment of the people should have effect on justices when they consider decisions, and where the line of separation is between the people's opinions and the court's duties and responsibilities?
As I stated in my remarks, I truly believe that a judge should look at the law and the Constitution, should be impartial in the way that she approaches an issue. I understand that, you know, there is public sentiment and people have strong feelings, but there are other ways for the public to express their concerns about an issue. The judges are invested with the authority and the responsibility to adjudicate it, to adjudicate without without considering personal values, political pressures. It's the judge's role to see beyond that. And again, like I said, to look at the laws and to look at the Constitution.
In a follow-up question to that, I noted you made a couple of comments about the relationship between the court and the public and perhaps something akin to a disconnection. What if that in fact exists, and I think there's some suggestion that it might, what do you think can be done?
Sure. I know that the Chief Justice and the court, they are, I believe, and Justice Wiggins, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but they're thinking about going out around the state and being more visible to Iowans so they better understand the function of the court and what it does. So first of all, I think the presence in the Iowa communities is paramount. People, unfortunately, don't know a lot about our courts. They feel that they are sequestered somewhere in Des Moines or in the courthouse. And so accessibility to the court is key. I think that's one thing that will be great to see happen. Another thing I think that can happen, Commissioner Fitzgibbons, is the continuing work of the court with the legislature and the executive branch, and also working very closely with the state bar associations and the local bar associations. Education, getting out into the schools. You know, I know that some will say, oh my gosh, if they're going around doing this PR work, when are they going to have time to write the decisions? Because certainly, you know, people need to have decisions issued. But I think there has to be a great balance there. And I think at this point in time, it's important that the Supreme Court and its justices have a face, that Iowans know who they are and what they do. And so those are some of the things that I think we can do, getting it, or the court can do, getting into schools when time permit, working closely with the legislature, the executive branch, and the associations, the legal associations.
Are there any questions from this side of the table? Mr. Brody.
Yes, and I want to also thank you for your interest and your efforts so far. I know you can't speak to some specifics. However, I also know that the Civil Rights Division at USDA is a very, very busy group of attorneys. How do you, and what is your approach that works best for you when you're approaching the matters that are before you? Kind of builds on Mr. Fitzgibbon's question before, but can you talk to some specifics about how you look at each individual case,
sure,
each issue that you need to address?
Sure. When we're presented with a case, you know, be it at the U.S. Attorney's Office or in USDA Office of the General Counsel, as you well know, you first analyze the case, what the allegations are, since I usually defend either the United States or the Department of Agriculture. I also, as I've said, take a look at the laws, and I look at case history and precedent, and formulate a position based on my research, and I work with my client in trying to understand what the needs of the client are. As the attorneys know, you know, you give reasoned advice based on research and analysis, and sometimes the client may not want to go that direction, but it's incumbent upon a lawyer to do her best to be well-informed and educated and knowledgeable about the law.
I think we have time for one more question. Is there another question? Ms. Dixon.
Also, thank you on behalf of the commission for your participation in this process. You've been in Washington, D.C. since 2004. Can you just speak briefly as to how you've stayed connected with the Iowa Bar since you've taken on your last position?
Sure. I haven't been active in the Iowa Bar per se, but as you well know, and I've shared with a lot of the commissioners, I still come home quite a bit. I commute. My husband and I commute here, and so we have the opportunity to interact with lawyers quite a bit. And so even though I'm not actively engaged in the workings of the Iowa State Bar Association at this time, I'm still kept apprised. I still, you know, keep up with what's going on. I'm aware of the issues that are facing the judiciary and the lawyers, and so that's how I keep informed.
Maybe one more question. We have about 20 seconds left. Mr. Cook?
Your husband in the past was a candidate for the legislature, and I'd like for you to give us your thoughts on the court's role vis-a-vis the legislature.
Well, again, the court is a co-equal branch with the Iowa legislature, whose charge is very different from the legislature, but I think there has to be a communication and discourse with the legislature. The court looks to the legislature for its funding, so it's incumbent that there is that communication there, that the legislature understands the environment in which the court operates, what are the needs of the courts around the state. Again, it's incumbent upon the court to make sure that the legislature understands that there's some innovative things that the court wants to do that will allow access to the courts, to make sure the legislature understands what that means as far as funding goes. The long-term, I think, strategy of the court is important, that the legislature is aware of that. So there is a relationship that should be maintained and nurtured.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming. We appreciate candidates of your caliber applying for this position and wish you the best of luck. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Thank you.
Have a seat, Mr. Talbot. We'd like to welcome you to the hearings this morning, or the public interviews, I should say, and you may start with your opening statement.
Thank you. It does feel a bit like a hearing being this early in the process. good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning. Good morning.
Thank you for having me appear before you today. All of you that I've had communication with have been gracious, welcoming, and I would like to express my gratitude for your service to our judiciary, our community, and our state. In the short time we have available for this opening statement, we will discuss two matters. One, my qualifications, and two, the challenges I see facing the court for the next series of years. While we're discussing these things, I would like for each of you to consider a concept that we hear discussed in sports time and time again. Every great team has a great utility player. Every great team has a great utility player. The utility player is that player that is generally the most well-rounded on the team, not necessarily the best athlete, not necessarily the best trained athlete, but that player that can move seamlessly from position to position without loss of competency. And that's the general practice lawyer. The general practice lawyer is the utility player of law. During my working life, I have been fortunate to experience a vast array of trade and professional positions. As a young man, I was employed in farm labor, factory labor, carpentry, mechanics, and I have been employed as a cowboy, a truck driver, a gas station attendant, and a grease monkey. These skills have served me well, and they provided the financial resources necessary for me to attend the University of Northern Iowa, and then in later years, Drake University Law School. After receiving my business degree at the University of Northern Iowa, I had the fortune of being the operations manager of a metal fabrications plant. I later became an executive at our family-owned business. The business was raising horses, manufacturing livestock products, and the sales and distribution of those livestock products. At times, I was responsible for as many as 150 employees and a sales and distribution network of many hundreds. In 1986, my wife Jill, who I've been married to now for almost 30 years, Jill and I decided to change direction. And we decided to pursue my lifelong dream of being a lawyer. So we went off to law school at Drake University. And while my peers were pursuing positions on moot court, law review. I was busy working full-time as a real estate manager and raising two infant sons. In spite of this adversity, or perhaps because of this adversity, I graduated from law school a full semester early and with honors. Upon graduation from law school, our oldest son was being treated for some significant vision problems. Jill and I again discussed our future and decided to forego any opportunities in larger cities. We sought to have our son in smaller schools with smaller classes. We landed in Nevada, Iowa. I worked in Nevada as a general practice lawyer until joining the Newbro Law Firm in 2004, and we moved from Nevada to Ames. Throughout my law practice, I have consistently given 10 to 15% or more of my business hours to pro bono and community activities. That's evidenced by my 20 years of service to the Legal Aid Society of Story County and presently as a director of the Ames Community School District. Now, a general practice lawyer, I'm calling the utility player of law. The areas of law that I've practiced in include, but are not limited to, business transactions, criminal defense, title examination, real estate subdivision, general litigation, personal injury, family law, probate, mediation, and commissioners. It even includes the dreaded tax preparation work. Now, I seek to bring these skills to the 10 challenges I believe face the court. I'll review those challenges briefly. Number one and most daunting is the budget. The budget will permeate everything the court does for the coming years. The second task I see that requires immediate attention is a restoration or enhancement of the relationship with the general public and the Bar Association. Number three, enhanced relationships with the bench, clerks of courts, and court reporters. Number four, the creation of uniform mediation rules. At present, you can move from county to county and have completely different mediation rules. Number five, a review of advertising rules. Six, a rewrite of the rules of the Iowa Rules of Civil Procedure. Number seven is an accessibility to the courts issue. Move more cases to small claims. I understand it'll take some legislative action, but we need to move more cases to small claims and speed up small claim processing. It's an accessibility to the court issue. Number eight, fast track or deny interlocutory appeals. Number nine, there needs to be a review of the funding and the rules of the Grievance Commission. Number 10, and quite pressing, a review of Chapter 16 and the methods of electronic filing. Remedies for such a diverse group of issues will require both those traditional judicial skills and the skills of a general practitioner. Commissioners, over the next few days, you will be interviewing candidates with very special, very unique, and sometimes even awesome judicial skills. The skill I present to you is that of a tradesman, a businessman, a general practitioner. I am your utility player. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Talbot. Let's start on this side of the table. Does anybody have any questions? Mr. Holm.
Mr. Talbot, you mentioned that one of the challenges that's going to be facing the court system is in the area of budgeting, and I think that all of us here have discussed and are concerned about the effect of limited resources on the ability of the judicial system to deliver justice. What specific ideas do you have about economies that maybe can be achieved in the system or savings can be achieved even with the limited resources that we're dealing with currently?
I see two prongs there. The first, the court's already started, and that's Chapter 16 and the rules of electronic filing. Now, with the proper application of those rules and the proper timing, we will be able to share considerable resources. I'm in Story County. We are the first large pilot county, and presently it is an adventure. We're certainly not ready to foist this on the entire state. But the second part of that answer comes from my experience at the Ames Community School District. When I was solicited to run for that position, I looked at the budget and I thought there needed to be a $1.7 million trim. Within weeks of being elected, it became obvious that we needed a $3.5 million trim. And that's a considerable amount of money when you consider that 82 or so percent of that budget is paychecks, living, breathing, heart-beating people. When I went to the school board, I did not go with any edicts or a specific plan because I wanted collaboration and buy-in. And when I went in with that concept and with the cooperation of the other six members of the board, I did not get the $3.5 million I wanted, but we did get $3.1 million of reductions.
Mr. Talbot, I want to follow up on your utility player concept and theme that you presented here to us today. In looking at your application, you've listed the various practice areas, and I see that the practice area that you practice the least in is criminal defense. And, of course, you know that this court hears criminal cases, including appeals from first-degree murder convictions. Speak to us about whether you think you have the utility experience in criminal cases.
Thank you, Mr. Cook. The percentages that I put in my application material are based upon my current client list. As a general practice attorney, my cases have ebbed and flowed through the years. There are times when I've had substantial amounts of criminal work. I've defended an attempted murder case and secured an acquittal. I've tried multiple burglary cases. I believe, yes, I have the experience in criminal law. In fact, one of the prosecutors that I was visiting with recently suggested that it would be nice to have a criminal defense attorney like me on the bench to help understand some of those issues that are pressing at the misdemeanor level.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions on that anywhere there? Yeah. Ms. Williams?
Thank you for taking part in this process. There were 10 different items that you listed that you thought needed to be addressed if you were to be selected. And I was wondering if there was any particular order in which you would follow in order to address those 10 different items that you listed.
Thank you. I considered that issue. And the number one, I think, and most pressing issue is always going to be the budget. So the budget has to be examined first, foremost, and permeating the rest of the issues. I think number two is the electronic filing. At a very recent Story County Board of Supervisors meeting, the county attorney, Stephen Holmes, appeared at that meeting to discuss problems that he saw coming for the county attorney's office. Now, I don't want to misquote him, but I believe his statement was, the filing process at present takes him a third longer than paper filing. He was cautioning the Board of Supervisors that he will be looking for more assistance in his office. Right now, his office is merely processing juvenile-type cases, mental commitment-type cases. When they go online, electronically filing all criminal cases, his office is going to be in trouble. So I think we need to address the method of electronic filing quite rapidly. If you can imagine the kind of problems that would cause the county attorney's office, think out to all of those county seat practitioners that are trying to do this input by themselves. So I think that there is no particular order other than the budget is dominant and the electronic filing needs quick attention.
Ms. Redenbaugh, did you have a question? Or?
No. Thank you, Mr. Talbot, for being part of the process also. I've just been thinking, since you talked about your budgeting experience, I've been thinking about that and wondering then, you know, how you talked about cutting the school budget by so much and how it impacted people's lives because it was personnel issues. I'm just wondering how, if you have any, do you think that that is what one of the issues are with the budget and the judicial system? I mean, is that carry over to the judicial system that you're thinking with there are, that's an area that could be improved, or are there other ways that you think we could make the system more efficient and still have the integrity of the courts? I mean, specifically to the judicial system, do you see what issues we have?
It's a fabulous question, and it has a lot of layers. As far as efficiency, one of the things I talked about is the 10 items is access of citizens to the court. I talked to a couple of commissioners about this. The budget that many of our clients have for processing a case is hundreds, not thousands of dollars. And their budget prevents them from going through a case as you would imagine a typical medical malpractice case with months of discovery, months of depositions, and days of trial. I think that to get more accessibility of our public gives us relief in our budget. So that's one of the things that I believe is true and that we can attack immediately. I think that accessibility to the courts, we can start by asking the legislature to give us a statute, and I don't know the magic number. I think $10,000 of jurisdiction for small claims courts. The second thing we need to consider is how we can fast track some of our lower dollar cases. Frankly, we have a lot of auto injuries with less physical damage to people today because of our safer cars. So we have a lot of people in car collisions that have cases that may require recovery of $10,000, $18,000, $25,000. Well, with the cost of medical professional testimony, with the cost of depositions, it becomes an access to the court's issue as to whether or not those folks can seek recovery. I think if we collaborate with the district court and with the Bar Association, that we can come up with some form of fast tracking those smaller cases. I believe that will create great efficiencies at the district court level. I'm not sure about efficiencies at the district associate court level. Those folks have a full house. They're trying cases every week. The juvenile courts are full. I'm not sure where we find those efficiencies, but I think the access to the courts is one piece of where we can find some efficiency.
Mr. Mickelson, do you have a question?
Yes. Mr. Talbot, number two on your list, you talked about public restoration. Can you briefly tell me how you plan on increasing the visibility of the court to Iowans?
Once again, it requires collaboration between all of the justices on the court. If you come in with a predetermined plan and try and force it on the rest of the court, the plan won't work. So we start with collaboration as to building the plan, but my current concepts are merely being accessible to the public. Think about all the opportunities that a Supreme Court justice has to be with members of the public. Rotary clubs, Lions clubs, Kiwanis clubs, school functions and activities. The Bar Association has a school going on in Des Moines virtually every week of the year. There's no reason we can't drop in on tax school for a few hours. So my first concept is to become more accessible, but the full plan has to be developed by the court. If I just come with a plan and say this is what we're doing, it will not be successful. It has to be by collaboration with the rest of the justices.
I think we we have time for another question. Professor Cochran.
Mr. Talbot, you mentioned your pro bono work just now, and in your written materials you had, I think, one of the better lines we got in the mountain that we got this time around, where you spoke to your particular affinity for traveling musicians, impoverished farm wives, and college students who've made poor choices. I wonder if you could speak to why pro bono work has loomed so large in your practice and the kind of folks you've been able to help out.
Well, that's a very simple and short answer. My life has absolutely been blessed. If you look at the short information I gave you, Professor, everything that I've touched in my life has worked out well for me. I talked about my son's vision problems, completely remediated over the years. We had difficulties in business. It was an opportunity to go to law school. Everything has worked out well, and it is my duty as a moral person to help other people find wellness, to help them through the difficulties they're experiencing in life, particularly some of those college students that are just being foolish.
We have time for maybe one quick question. Any other questions over there?
I had one. Hi, Mr. Talbot. You talked about rewriting the Iowa Rules of Civil Procedure in some way. Can you give us some information about what you were referring to there?
Yes. The first problem that I see with the Iowa Rules of Civil Procedure is that they have been amended so many times that actually, it's difficult to find what you're looking for. We need to streamline the rules. There are some sections in there that I'm not sure really belong in the rules of civil procedure. For example, partition. Thank you for having me here. I appreciate your consideration.
Mr. Talbot, thank you. Thank you for putting your name in, and we appreciate well-qualified candidates like yourself applying. Thank you very much.